Hi everyone, it's Java with Les. Cheers. Okay, in part one of coyote calling competitions, how to be successful, I left off on locating coyotes, and I was talking about a situation where a friend of mine had actually tried locating coyotes and totally messed the whole area up, I felt. Now I'm going to give you my version as to how coyote locating has helped me and what I did to locate coyotes. I didn't really actually do anything other than alert a big old male coyote, and that's how it all started. So if you'll remember, we were going over the whiteboard, and we were right here on the locating landowner permission and then the locating coyotes. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about what happened to me and how it ended up being very successful for me and my partner. The year was 2006. One of the last times I really ever competed in coyote calling competitions in a very aggressive stance where I really wanted to try to win, if you will. And my brother wasn't actually my partner in this hunt. I had wanted to hunt with one guy that I'd known out in Saratoga, Wyoming when I lived there. And I wanted to hunt with this person. He was about 10 years older than me, trapped a lot of coyotes, called a lot of coyotes, he killed a lot of coyotes. So I competed against him and his brothers in the coyote calling competitions, my brother and I did. And I only knew of him placing once or twice in the top 10. Even though he lived in the area, he just was never the numbers guy, if you will. In order to be successful in killing competition coyotes or winning competitions, I feel like you have to be a numbers guy. You have to be able to high roll and blow through the country and just kill, 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 kill. It takes a special person to do that. Now in this situation, I was set up to be his partner. I didn't go out and scout before the competition because I knew right where I wanted to go hunt. I'd been out in that country. It was all public. I'd hunted there before, not much calling, but I'd always seen coyotes there, and I said, that's where we need to hunt. We're driving my pickup, and we leave Rawlins. It's probably 4 a.m. And we drive, and we had about an hour on the interstate, and then we're about an hour off the interstate. So we're a long ways back in there. And we get back in there, and it's still dark. I pull into this spot, and I told him, I said, we're going to have to walk 200-300 yards at least. I don't even really remember how far it's going to be. Just a spot I eyeballed before that I've never called it, but I wanted to start there. So basically my partner, he only wanted to be the downwind guy. He didn't want nothing confrontational right up front. He said, you're good enough at killing coyotes. You call, you shoot. And he said, any backdoor coyotes, I'll try to take a hold of. So that's the way we ran our calling platform. I carried a shotgun and a rifle on every stand. And I tried to call coyotes right to me. And anything that tried to slip in, he was going to get or get an opportunity at. So we get out of the vehicle, it's still pretty dark. I told him, I said, let's try to walk in, we'll get set up, I'll have you go straight downwind of me, and basically we'll sit there until it gets light enough where I think I can see good enough to shotgun a coyote, and then I'll start calling. So we slip in, and we're going over these hills. We get back in there, and there's a little ridge. And I said, okay, you go down this ridge about 100, 150 yards. And the wind was kind of blowing that away, so he was going to be right downwind of me. So I seen him walk off, and it was getting a little bit light enough I could still see him for quite a ways, but he just kind of disappeared, and I gave it quite a while yet because I couldn't see the best. So as I'm sitting there, it starts getting a little bit more light, and I have my binos, and I'm glassing, and I had this hill in front of me about 300 yards, 400 yards, a bald hill. So I thought, okay, if I call, that's going to be a perfect spot for one to just show up, right on top of that highest hill there. So I let it get light enough that I could see the hill good and I could start seeing everything pretty clear. So I'm hunkered down and I call. I made one series. I didn't go long. I went pretty crazy. I just real erratic. Just trying to wake them all up, let them know I'm there, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't call real loud and I shut up. Sitting there looking. And it was probably 2 minutes into the stand. I hadn't called again. That was my first series. All of a sudden, there's right over that bald hill that was in front of me, a lone male. Ooh. Ooh. Woo! And he barked at the end. That was the key to all this. Okay? Instantly, I go, crap, we've been made. He saw us walk in. He's warning every coyote in the country. So I just sat there. Couldn't see him. He was over the top of the bald hill that I said was about 300 to 400 yards away. He was right on the back side of that sucker. About a minute later, he starts howling again. Ooh, you know, he does his thing. And see what he did, he howled, but he called his bitch in. So when he howled the second time, he howls, and about halfway through his howl, his bitch chimes in with him. Well, he called her in, they got together, they letting everybody know around the country, you know, just letting everybody know there's something fishy going on here. Pretty soon as they got done howling, we're sitting there. This is game day. This is the first day of the competition. Pretty soon, coyotes started. There'd be one over here howl. Then one over here howl. Then one over here howl. Then two over there and two clear back there. Pretty soon, the whole country's just howling. It's dead calm. My brain is just, it's frying. It's on overload. I'm hearing two over there, and I'm guessing them. I'm saying, okay, there's two miles over there. There's one I could barely hear over there. That's probably 3 miles. Mentally, I'm trying to plug them all into my brain and think, okay, I know where that one's at. I know where that one's at. There's one behind me. Then there's two more clear behind him. There's one over there, and it was unreal, okay? I heard probably no less than 15 different coyotes howl, okay? Including the ones that were right in front of us. But there was one or two more that were pretty close to us that were right over here. So I never called again. I let everything get settled back down and let everything calm back down. No more howling. Everything's quiet. I sat there long enough to make sure they weren't going to slip in on us. I get up and I walk down to my partner. Sneak. And I got down to him. I said, let's go. And he said, what? Why are we leaving? I said, let's go. Let's go get my vehicle and I'll tell you what's going on. So we go. We get back to my vehicle. Now, mind you, this guy's 10 years older than me, right? And I'm telling him what to do. So he's a little on edge going, what the heck? I just heard 15 coyotes howl and you're wanting to leave. Okay. But I have my own theories, I have my own philosophies, I have my own reasons for doing things. I'd remember hearing one howl about a mile and a half down the way, straight east of us. At least a mile and a half. I thought it could be a mile and a half to 2 miles. So we got to my pickup, we got back out on the road, and I looked at my odometer and just took off. I'm driving 70 miles an hour, and he's like, why didn't we go up over that hill and kill those two coyotes? I said, Robin, had we went and had I sat there and called, that whole country would have been messed up from that one stand. He said, yeah, but we could have went and got them two coyotes. And I said, two coyotes is nothing. I want to get 12 of them. I don't want to get just two. I want to pick them off one by one. So I'm driving straight to the east and I'm doing 70 mile an hour and I look at my odometer and I hit a mile and a half and I started slowing down looking at the train out there and there's a hill I could park behind, so I wheeled in and I parked. We skedaddle out there, I'm carrying my 12 gauge and my rifle. I set up, he goes right downwind of me about 50 yards. I blow on the call again. Here comes a coyote just ripping in. I pull up the shotgun, 10 yards, boom, done. Okay, that was the one coyote I heard. Then we ended up working that whole area, and at about 10 o'clock in the morning, the wind came up big time. That's a great thing when you're calling condensed stuff that is full of coyotes, that you know there's a lot of coyotes in, because you're not gonna mess up the whole country. When it's calm, one call and one gunshot, and you're messing up the whole country, okay? So that day, to make a long story short, we killed 9 coyotes, and the wind got tremendously bad, like 30, 40 mile an hour, we killed 9 coyotes, okay? But we went in and we picked off a single here, picked off one here, picked off one here. Because I had them all marked in my brain. I kind of knew where I thought they were. We come back the next day. We started a long ways away. But by noon, by 11:55 a.m., we had 11 coyotes in the back of the pickup. And then we drove to check-in, so we killed 9. We killed 11 on the short day, so we killed 20 coyotes in a day and a half. The moral of the story is, I let those coyotes tell me where they were. I never had to let out a howl. And I've had that happen to me a lot over the years. And my brother would even tell me that I'm crazy. We'd walk into a spot 400 yards to make a stand. We'd get in there, and then all of a sudden, we'd sit down, get ready to call, and all of a sudden, a coyote would howl over there. Well, then another one would howl over there, and another one over there. So I'd go, let's get out of here and let's go get closer to that one. Not wanting to call from where we were because I knew that one wouldn't come in. Even though it was close enough, I didn't think it would come that far. And I didn't think there was one right by us, or that coyote was howling to let everybody know that he saw us walking in. So I got the heck out of there, went around, call them in, and get right on top of them and call and boom, kill them. So that was the moral of the story on locating coyotes. If you've ever walked into a spot and set up and getting ready to call and all of a sudden one howls out there, sometimes it's best to get out, go around, try to get closer to that coyote and then call him in, because he just told you where he was, you know? So that was a pretty neat scenario. We're going to move on into a whole nother realm now. Before I start talking about what weapons and hand calls versus electronic calls, I want to first talk a little bit about a stand situation and how long I would call at these spots. Typically, predator calling in a competition, you want to hurry, 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 because the name of the game is getting the most coyotes. So you got to hurry up and get one, try to get another one, get another one, get another one. So sometimes that's a dual-edged sword, though, because sometimes you can slow things down, make fewer stands, but better quality, higher quality stands that look better, you can set there longer, and you can actually possibly call one in from that, something that takes a little bit longer for them to come in and make the shot. So typically what I've done over the years, and I want to show you my graph. Here we go again on the whiteboard. But you can see how long I'd typically call would be 10 minutes or 15 minutes. Or what would I do, you know? A lot of times in competition scenario, my goal for making a stand was, once I called the first series, I wanted to be on that stand at least 15 minutes. No matter how many series I made in between to get to that 15, what I always tried to do was I would try to make a series, say at 12 or 13 minutes, And then I wanted to sit there for 2, 3, 4 minutes and just see if anything showed up. Now, a lot of the places I was calling, it was wide open terrain. So if a coyote was at a half mile coming in, you could see him and it might take him 4 minutes to get to you. So I sat there quiet for a long time because I wanted to try to make that animal show its face. So that way I saw him and then I would know that, hey, I've got a coyote coming in. I need to sit here longer. So typically, I'm going to say that I set most stands 15 minutes. That was my goal. And another aspect of that, a little secret, I should say, I had a brother team come up to me in the hunt. They were having problems finding a coyote. They weren't calling any. And that day, the first day of the hunt, they only shot one coyote. They were driving down a two-track trail with their four-wheeler. They come popping up over the hill. There was a coyote right in front of them on the two-track. The one got off, and it was hunting. They never even knew they were there because it was windy. They got off the four-wheeler, laid on the ground prone, shot, drilled that coyote. Well, then they just, it was wide open country, so they kept tootling along. And I think they only killed two coyotes all day. And he come up to me, he said, man, I just don't think we're in coyotes. And I said, well, you killed a couple, didn't you? Yeah, we did, but we just never done any good. I said, well, when you killed the one coyote on the four-wheeler, what did you do? Well, we just, it was wide open, so we kept going. And I said, well, one of the tricks in calling coyotes is they're a social animal. Especially when they get kicked out for the year, they're on their own. They've been weaned. This little male coyote remembers his little female sister, and she might only be a mile away, but they're just wandering through the country hunting, you know. So they howl, and they know each other's howls. So I told him, I said, the next time if you ever kill a coyote, try calling right there. Go try calling three directions around that coyote. One on each side and then straight in front. Well, lo and behold, the very next day, they were doing the exact same thing. They killed a coyote on their four-wheeler, or after they were driving on their four-wheeler, and they made a stand to the east, to the west, and to the north, and they killed two more coyotes out of three more stands. So he said, man, your theory on that worked that time. So that's something to keep in mind. I'm not going to say it's going to work every time, but typically when I'm going out across the country and I make one stand and I kill a coyote, I'm calling something close by right there because there's a good possibility there's another coyote right in that immediate area. So it's just something to think about. It's pretty easy when you're trying to go out across the country as fast as you can to hit as many stands as you can, but you've got to slow your brain down a little bit and think about the coyote philosophy on why they're going to be close to another coyote, and that pays off a lot of times. There's a lot of times I'll kill a coyote and a coyote come over a hill and I shot him right there. I'll go over that hill where he came from, call in another coyote and kill him. So it just pays to try those little things, especially when you're in coyote country, they're responding. That's something you need to pay attention to. Now let's take it the whole different direction. Say perhaps I'm in a coyote calling competition and I've made three stands and I've never called a coyote. And I'm not seeing a coyote. I've glassed a lot. There's nothing. It's devoid of coyote life. A lot of times, if I've called three spots that just look tremendous to my eyes, and I think, man, there should have been a coyote here somewhere. Something's going on. A lot of times, I will pack up, jump in the vehicle, drive down the road 5-10 miles, and then I'll try another spot. I will get out of that area. It'll be another area that I have in my mind that I'm going to go try, and I'll just get the heck out of Dodge and go try somewhere else, because I feel like early in the year, November, I should be calling or seeing a coyote 1 in 3 stands. I should at least see one moving out across the country. I should see one coming to the top of a hill looking at us. I should see some form of coyote life, especially if I've made really good, high-quality stands, in my opinion. So if I don't call one, I'm moving. I'm changing game plans. Now, bear in mind, this is for Western calling. Eastern United States, when you're calling timber, it's going to be totally different. You're not going to be wanting to shoot for a 15-minute stand. You're probably going to want to up that a little bit. If I'm calling timber and I know that there's coyotes in the area, I'm going to end every stand. End every stand on a coyote. And what that is a coyote distress. And I'm going to have another video out that talks about the coyote or the coyote in distress call. And if you're not sure of what that is, just look at all my videos and I'm sure you're going to find it. But I want to let, say I'm calling the timber and I've sat there for 20 minutes, nothing showed up, I don't see anything. I'm going to end on the note of, okay, there's a coyote in distress. Yipe, 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 yipe. And a lot of times, if a coyote was hung up back in the timber, it hears that instantly, that coyote in distress, and it's like, oh my gosh, Bob's in trouble. I got to go see what's going on. So they'll work their way to the edge of the timber. So you'll see them just a lot of times that fast. So I'm going to end every stand on a coyote in distress series where I may only call for 15 seconds, but it's going to be crazy 15 seconds. I'm going to be loud, I'm going to be obnoxious, and it's going to be hardcore coyote in distress. And I'll do it, I'll sit there and wait, and I'll look, and I'll wait, and I'll look, and I'll wait. And I may wait one more minute, and I'll do it again for another 15 seconds, then I'll shut up, and I'll sit there, and I'll just give them a little bit of time to show their face. Now, you get their curiosity going, and they want to see what the heck is going on. And I'm going to do another video on what I call the bawling baby syndrome or the bar fight curiosity level in a coyote. And that will give you an idea as to what they're thinking. Okay, so that's wooded versus Western United States open terrain calling. That's how I'm going to end it. I'm going to call a little bit longer in the wooded country than I would in the open West, because in the open West, I can see so much further. Other strategies that go along with the calling I'm going to talk about right now. Okay, and that strategy was, and I already said it, was calling close to where you previously called or killed one. Where I just said, you know, going down the trail, you kill one, so now you call 400 yards from this direction, 400 yards that direction. You try to call on any side of that coyote because that coyote's traveling through the country and chances are there's another coyote close to it, okay? Now, in another spot, You're gonna call a great travel area more than one time. So say you've got a great calling spot. Say the first stand of the morning, you're calling this river bottom, and there's a lot of cover and it's fairly windy. You got a 10 to 15 mile an hour wind, and it's a beautiful travel corridor for coyotes. You see their tracks in the snow, or you see a lot of scat, you see a lot of tracks in the dirt. You know that it's a high travel corridor for coyotes. They're moving up and down it all the time. Like at 1 in the afternoon, there's another coyote traveling through, or 2 in the afternoon, or 5 in the afternoon. You call it first stand in the morning, boom, real quick, you kill a coyote. You leave that stand, you go make more stands throughout the day, you go back to that same exact stand, last stand of the evening, call it again, and you could very possibly kill another coyote. Because in a high travel area, coyotes are moving up and down that area at all hours of the day. Because in the winter months, coyotes aren't always all bedded up during the day. There's some areas where when it's thick woods, they're hunting. They may be hungry, so they're traveling through the woods hunting. So I like to call a high profile spot more than one time in one day, or I will call it the very next day again. Now, in one time during a competition, my brother and I in the National out in Wyoming, we called a spot first stand in the morning, killed a coyote, come back right at sundown, called it again, killed another coyote. So we killed two coyotes out of one spot, making two different stands during one day. So, or you can break it up, call it one day, call it the next day. If it's a great area, you don't kill one the first day, slip back in the next day and try a different sound and see if you can maybe pull one in. You just know it's a good spot. That is some of the things that I like to do whenever I'm in really high profile areas. I also would cut down the distance in between stands. If it's calm out, I may go a mile. If it's 10 to 15 mile an hour wind, sometimes I'll only go 400 yards and make another stand, 500-600 yards. And in really windy conditions, 20 to 40 mile an hour winds, I'm calling every half mile for sure. And maybe even shorter than that. I've actually called every 400 yards when it's really, really, really windy. In windy conditions, what I found is they're on top of you instantly. If you call, sometimes I haven't even got the call out of my mouth and they're looking at me at 40 yards. And the reason being is in the windy conditions, 40 mile an hour wind, I'm getting down out of the flat stuff in the breaks. And typically I'm calling willows or creek bottoms, high sagebrush, the thicker of the thick, because that's where they're hunting rabbits. And they once they kill a rabbit, they just bed down right there. And if you slip into those spots, a lot of times when you call and wake them up and you're blowing loud and it's echoing, they're gonna show up fast, especially if they're hungry. Like they're gonna run in. And a lot of times in high windy conditions, we shotgun a lot more coyotes. For whatever reason, it's a coyote that's hungry and he just will run in instantly and he wants to try to eat whatever's there. And that's the coyote you're gonna kill. Pretty much the calling scenarios that I've ever entered into in competition arena was either the 1 day or the 1.5 day. I call it a 1.5 day. It's kind of like a 2 day or 1.75 day. But typically everything I entered was 1.5 days. And with that said, there was usually the way they checked your coyotes, because some of the places where you hunted the first day, you just had to call in and let them know how many coyotes you saw and that you harvested. So if you harvested 5 coyotes, they wrote that down in the books for the first day that you killed 5. So whenever you came to check in the next day, you either had to put mouth blocks in them or you had to have some form of how you mark those coyotes, and you wrote on say a block was in its mouth, and when rigor mortis sets up, that coyote's mouth clamps shut. So if you had a mouth block in there, there's no way of getting it out, and you zip tie it so it stays in there. You wrote the time and the day that you killed that coyote. So in other words, say you killed it at 1:27 p.m. in the afternoon on the first day. Well, when you went to check in, that coyote is going to be like 15 other coyotes that were killed in that same time. So your temperature had better jive with all them other coyotes. So they did that just to keep the chance or possibility of cheating, so that somebody isn't shooting them at night and saying, okay, we killed that one. You know, we only killed 4 today, but let's say we killed 5 and then we'll kill one this evening somewhere out there spotlighting. They did that to cut down on everything, so your coyote better jive with everybody else's. I hope you like this so far. We're gonna go into part 3 now of coyote calling competitions. So please hit that subscribe button and hit that little bell right beside it. That will give you a notification on any time I upload a video. It'll tell you, hey, you've got a new video online from Everything Outdoors with Les Johnson, and give me a thumbs up. The more thumbs ups I get, it puts me higher in the standings and the search engine access. That way other people can find me easier, and I am a recommended video then when it comes to coyote calling competitions. I'm going to get out of here right now. I'm going to drink a little more Java, but we're going to slip into part three next, and we're going to talk about the weapons I use, why, and then we're going to slip into hand calls versus electronic calls, and then we're going to go into stand situations on how long I think you should call at a stand, and what some other techniques are to increase your success in those areas when you're in a competition setting. Until next time, thank you for watching.